I'd like to welcome you to today's discussion on Syrian women in civil society and politics. Our featured speakers today both fit the description in the event title, but also lead organizations that are networked with many civically engaged women throughout non-regime and non-ISIS held areas of Syria and beyond. It has been our honor here at MEI to host Salma Kahale and Oula Ramadan for a week of briefings and encounters with the administration, the Congress, and the NGO community. We were able to do this with the generous assistance of the Asfari Foundation, for which I'd like to express our gratitude for their support. Our moderator for today's event will introduce Salma and Oula somewhat more thoroughly and lead us through the event until about 1:15 this afternoon. Our guest moderator, Leila Hilal, is a fellow at the International Security Program and former director of the Middle East Task Force at New America. She is an attorney and legal scholar trained in the United States, but whose rich experience includes serving as a law clerk to a judge on South Africa's constitutional court. Ms. Hilal has also served as a senior policy advisor to the Commissioner General of the Palestinian Refugee Agency, the UN Relief and Works Agency, and as a legal advisor to the Palestinian negotiating team from 2002 to 2008. She has led numerous research missions on human rights, on post-conflict scenario building, and transitional justice, all of which are topics that Salma and Oula have been discussing with Washington's Syria policy community for the last 3 days. Middle East Institute is delighted to have Leila here today to lead this conversation. I'd like to thank you all again for coming. Leila, the floor is yours.
Hello. Can you hear me? Is it okay? So it's a great pleasure and honor to be able to moderate this discussion today with Salma and Oula, two prominent Syrian civil society leaders that are working for peace, justice, and women and youth rights inside Syria. I'll just do a quick rendering of their bios, I believe longer ones that have been made available to you in the invitation. Salma is the executive director of Dawlaty. which supports Syrian civil society and young people to engage in democratic transitional processes through capacity building, community mobilization, and advocacy. Dawlaty is based in Beirut and staffs centers in 6 provinces inside Syria. Salma is also a founding member of Planet Syria, an international campaign advocating for civilian protection and meaningful peace negotiations. During her professional life in Syria, she worked with the Office of the First Lady on youth engagement and civil society from 2009 until April 2011, when she left for political reasons. Oula is the founder and executive director of Badael Foundation, a Syrian nonprofit organization based in Turkey, committed to strengthening Syrian civil society and grassroots efforts in peace building, human rights, and nonviolence. She was a human rights advocate in Syria from 2003, which resulted in a travel ban on her by the regime from 2006 until 2011. In 2011, she became very active in supporting a political transition in Syria and promoting political activism amongst Syrian women. She is a researcher whose writing focuses on civil society and peace building in Syria, and she will speak a bit about some of her research products and findings. The achievements of Salma and Oula and their colleagues are evidence of how Syrian women activists and civil society have substantially expanded their role and impact since 2011. Far from the images of death, destruction, and terrorism that saturate media, ones that have led many to dismiss Syria as a mess, finished, and other conclusions. Syrian women and civil society have been adapting, innovating and really keeping it all together. They represent moderation and coexistence. They are really the linchpin for peace. So Salma and Oula's presence in Washington gives us a chance to understand better what is really happening in Syria and how and whom we should link to move beyond the impasses of today. This week, which, well, you have been in Washington, has been one of very eventful one on Syria. The Geneva talks have stumbled into a technical abyss, and the ceasefire that offered some civilian space has been blown apart by apparent direct attacks on activists and medical professionals working against all forms of tyranny and for civilian protection. This means that there's still a lot to do to resolve the conflict. And so without further ado, I turn to Oula and Salma to provide perspective. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for being here. I'm honored to speak to all of you. I would like to thank first the Middle East Institute for hosting us and for Asfari to support this program. What actually I would like to start with is basically providing or telling a little bit about the main finding of a recent report that we did on the women peace activism inside Syria. The report is here called Peacebuilding Defines Our Future. There are some copies, I think, available there. And I'll quickly mention some of the findings, as I said. One of the main reasons why actually we did this report is because women are usually perceived as victims but not as agents of change. And that's what we wanted to basically highlight in this report, is by saying what are actually women doing inside the country and what kind of activism that they are still able to carry out after 5 years of war and violence. The other thing is that we always hear over the media, like the information that is coming about war, who is fighting who bombed, you know, like the bombing and ISIS is getting advanced, etc. But we rarely hear information or no information about what are actually, how the people are living in those areas and what are the civil, do we have a movement still inside Syria and what are those, you know, actors inside are able to do and achieve. And this is one of the reasons why we wanted to highlight the role of women and civil society in general. I mean, this report is one report out of others that we published about the civil society in general. We in Badael work on strengthening civil society grassroots groups inside the country. As mentioned in peace building, human rights, and nonviolence, and we've been working over the past 3 years on with over 200 civil society grassroots groups. So we realize as a foundation that there are so much work that has been done and carried out by civil society actors and women groups inside the country, and this information is not available for public. Part of it is because of security reasons, but other part is related to the interest of people of knowing about those kind of movements. We have, quickly about this research, we have mapped 61 women groups inside the country. Unfortunately, only 49 of them were able or accepted to talk to us or basically provide information. And the 11 group or the 12 group who didn't feel safe to provide information were mainly from regime area. While we managed actually to get to some or to few groups in ISIS-controlled area where we managed to like learn more about their work. One of the main findings in this research that women groups are so active, especially in the last 2 years, there was a huge need for them, especially after like men went to fight or get involved more in the armed kind of work, or get arrested or were killed, etc. So women felt that, you know, there is a huge gap that they need to fill, and they started to become more and more active, and there is absolutely an increase of the women groups and activists inside the country. When it comes to peace work, women organizations and small groups in different conflict areas are basically working on containing and reducing violence. And it's very interesting to see how women groups actually were able to design projects and initiative that is based on the needs of their areas. I'll give some examples. In Damascus, for example, the 11 groups that we managed to talk to and learn about their experience, we found out that there's a lot of focus there on political activism of women. There are pretty much, you know, awareness raising on the 1325 UN resolution that talks about the inclusion of women in the peace processes. And women were basically raising awareness about, you know, how important it is to have women in the decision-making place, in the negotiation, on the negotiation table, and the importance of having their voices from now here to be able to build, you know, like a better future for Syria. While we see, so we see this kind of focus in Damascus, and it's very clear for us that Damascus as the center, as the capital, even prior to 2011, there was a couple of women groups who were very active and feminist, trying to fight for women's rights, especially focusing on the nationality, as Syrian women are not able, for example, to pass their nationality to their kids. So there was this movement in Damascus, and the members of those groups are, feminist women who've been fighting for women's rights for decades. So we see much more awareness when it comes to the political in Damascus, while, for example, in Hasaka region, we see that women intended to focus on the political participation of women and the leadership role, but as well on the coexistence between the different combination in that region. And Hasaka is quite a diverse provenance in Syria, where you have Kurds, Arab, Assyrians, Yazidis all together. And women did realize that, you know, the conflict between the different component has been carried out for 100 years or more, and it's very important to work now on the coexistent part, because if there is any escalation in the violence in that region, so they will manage throughout this kind of project and initiative to contain, you know, the violence or prevent the violence. While we see in women groups in Aleppo, for example, quite focusing on child recruitment, because they identified as one of the main problems in their region. So what I wanted to say is that women were quite aware of what actually the needs on in the area where they work or where they are from, and they tried to design projects and initiative and advocate for a specific issue. And the other very interesting finding basically in this report is how creative women are. They most of the women in groups that we interviewed or who are our partners actually, we do provide them with different kind of support. They were very creative in dealing with their problems. I'll give an example of a group in the countryside of Aleppo where they basically identified child recruitment as a problem, and then they were not able to actually do this kind, you know, like in public, announce that they are doing things related to child recruitment. So what they basically did is they invited women for literacy courses, and throughout the literacy courses, they start educating them about the consequences of sending their children to fight. So that's one of the very creative way that women, in order not to put themselves under a huge risk, because if they announce such kind of project, they will be absolutely facing a huge risk from the armed group who are controlling that area, as they are the one who are recruiting children. While we see in an Atmi camp, which is an IDP's camp close to the Turkish border, women identified small weapons, the spread of small weapons as a problem, and they start working throughout campaigns to advocate to limit basically the number of small weapons in that camp. So that's, I mean, That's basically how women are doing this kind of work, but they are hardly, you know, finding anyone to support them. I mean, we do, one of the main challenges that women are facing nowadays, or like civil society in general inside the country, is that they are small groups, borders are closed, it seems to be very hard to communicate with the outside world, and not much of international organizations or other are actually interested in sub-granting or like providing small grants with whatever 10,000 or 20,000 euro to or dollar to support their projects. So there are plenty of huge challenges that's related to mobility, that's related to the, of course, security situation and the protection of civilians, but as well to get, you know, support, whether it's technical, whether it's capacity building or money to this group to continue, because they are the one in the front line and they are the one who is trying to keep their communities together. I think I'll stop here and pass it probably to Salma, and then maybe we can have...
I turn it on, or is it on already? It's on? It's on? Okay. So I'm just going to maybe speak briefly about... I work with Dawlaty, a small Syrian organization that works with activists and young people to get their voices... to first of all, engage them in democratic transition. So that's whether through doing... simplifying concepts related to civic education, democratic democracy, or transitional justice, and making them accessible to a young Syrian audience, or through also doing consultations and questionnaires, interviews with young people and with activists on what they see as their priorities, what are their expectations for the future, and where they see their role. I'm based in Beirut, but our staff is based in six different areas in Syria, some in the north and some in the south of Syria. We've also done capacity building with many groups of activists on issues related to advocacy, political participation of women, and community organizing. Just some of the points that Oula mentioned, starting with before she mentioned that in Damascus, women have been organizing for many years on women's issues, and this was it used to be an official outlet where you could actually talk about rights. You know, women's issues was an area where you could actually organize, because initially the state didn't see that as something that was, it fit into their, yes, we are pro-women's rights, we're secular, so they would allow some sort of organizing. But when they saw, I think, and many women, some groups started organizing around writing a shadow report to the convention, to the women's rights on CEDAW, and to also do advocacy on violence against women, on citizenship, other issues. But they also would raise the issue that women's rights are part of human rights, and if you don't have human rights, you're not. And that started to become... more and more the regime realized that actually maybe talking about women's rights isn't as safe as they thought it would be. And then when the revolution started in 2011, many more women were involved in organizing, whether they were involved in protests or providing humanitarian support or other kinds of organizing and resistance. But there was still this gap between, there still remained a gap between those women who had been organizing officially or who were involved in many of this legal work, broader campaign work, and between the women who were working on the ground. So you continue to see the same women who had been involved in the international organizations work still continue to be the ones representing different groups on an international in the international context and in the peace some peace processes without necessarily having links to the women who were working and organizing on the ground. We see that there was some attempts to kind of, as these women who were organizing at, continue to organize for women's rights, particularly for women to be involved in peace processes, there were groups that were formed to provide, to push the UN and to push the different that women be represented on negotiations. But there wasn't necessarily a broader connection with grassroots women and their work. And this is, we see that slowly there has been kind of a pickup on, and the de Mistura's team, in their work on engaging women in negotiations, have tried to create certain bodies to include women, but this has been done in a way that, unfortunately, doesn't provide for these different groups of women to be involved in the processes, but actually is focused has narrowed women's participation to this very small group of women, but also very select and unrepresentative group. It's also what's happened is when women started organizing to be involved in negotiations, they were organizing under the banner of women and democracy, or peace and democracy. Somehow, democracy, was taken out of this equation, it was like women are, women as peacemakers, women want peace, this is all about just pushing for an agreement in a way that is further instrumentalized women as, okay, you are going to speak in this, you are peacemakers, this is what you should be pushing for, and also brought women that didn't necessarily find common interests to sit together because there was a need to say women want peace and this is what they should be doing, which has kind of, has negative repercussions for a lot of women who have been organizing locally and also in terms of pushing for further negotiation or involvement in negotiations. Those are just a few.
I think that it's really a fascinating point that you're both making, which is that in your research, Oula, you said that women who are living in, who are outside of the capital, Damascus, are working more towards social cohesion and trying to mitigate violence, and that they're really in the community. And then, Salma, I heard you say that those women are not necessarily represented, nor potentially are their interests represented in the current peace process, which has a women's advisory body, which is being led by the UN Women, the agency of the UN for women, I think this hits on a challenge that a lot of people have been grappling with, particularly with Syria, which is that you have at the community level a lot of very important active work going on to create to preserve the community. And that given the level of violence and from multiple actors, sometimes the only thing that people can really accomplish is at the grassroots level. And your research and your work has really brought out many fascinating examples. And the question then becomes, how do we enable those people, the women at the grassroots, as well as their efforts to impact more national or international peace negotiations? I think it's a hard question, and I don't expect you to have answers because people are grappling with it. But if you can reflect on it, perhaps by suggesting how the UN could have gone about involving women in a different way, or some thoughts on how the process could be improved in terms of inclusivity.
Okay, so I think I think, as you mentioned, Leila, there was a huge gap between the track one level, the people who are in decision making, and that grassroots who are basically doing the work on the ground. And for any peace processes to be successful, it needs to bring all the voices of the people all together and be reflected in the process. And how to do that, I think, there are different ways to do it, but at least understanding that there is a problem, there is a gap, is part of, you know, like finding solution to it. I mean, one of the things that can be done is to bring those voices of the civil society and women in groups into the peace talk, to Geneva, to meet and see decision makers and tell what they want to say. So this is one thing that can be done. And the other thing that is basically using different channels. There are plenty of civil society organizations based in Turkey and Lebanon, in Jordan, who have teams inside the country and do a lot of cross-border work that they can carry on consultations with the grassroots to hear what the grassroots actually wants. It can be done through Skype calls and conference with the decision makers, with the Mistura team. But what's pretty much important is not to neglect those voices and also to put, I would say, not to make their voices heard only to Dimistura and his team, but also to the conflicting parties, you know, like putting more pressure on the HNC to like meet with people and see what do they think and reflect basically that into the peace talk. One thing that I would like to add here is that looking at the inclusion of women or participation of women in the peace talk right now, it's very weak. Although we have an advisory board of 12 women, and we have another advisory board for the opposition, but we still have a very low percentage, like two ladies in the opposition in the HNC, which is almost nothing. I mean, all the women, even in this report, were advocating that we need at least 30% of women in the on the negotiated table, and more pressure is actually needed here. And another thing that need to be be done is that, okay, advisory board are good. They're doing consultation. They're doing some part of the technical support, but they can't be representative because, you know, they were not. Basically, they were chosen in a different way that a representative body can be chosen. So to create a platform for women, for other women and activists and feminist groups to, you know, to influence the peace processes. Do you want to add?
Oula said most of those. Just a few points on the importance of providing information to the civil local groups of what is happening and what is being said in their names, what the statements are. Often a lot of course, negotiations that require closed doors, but there's also a lot in terms of explaining processes to people and also, having different groups explicitly state their positions, at least their starting positions and their demands, that I think is very important. People have a right to know what is happening in these negotiations as a first step for them to be able to get their voices across. I think also something that has been starting amongst civil society groups is that they're starting to put clear position papers or positions, the statements that they're releasing on what they think of negotiations, what do they think of some of the topics that are being discussed, and then to do advocacy on that. So that started very, you know, it has been more informal. It's not one group that is creating these kinds of, specifically one set of organizations that is creating this, but there is a kind of, I think more and more civil society groups are trying to say, okay, well, at least we can agree amongst ourselves what we would like to see and where we stand on issues, and then to try and use that to push to get their voices. So I think if we can get more of that involvement of those groups and those kinds of creating those positions, then whoever goes to Geneva can at least have that as a base. They know, you know, what are the needs on the ground and what are the expectations.
Okay. I'm conscious of the fact that you are not in Washington just to talk about what's happening in Geneva, but also to speak about what's happening in your work and inside Syria. Before we open it up, can you just perhaps provide some reflections on the messages that you've been giving during your meetings with Congress and U.S. officials, and also your perceptions of how the U.S. government understands Syria? Are they getting it right? Are they not? Where are the gaps?
I guess I can start with the fact that we've been talking to, as we go and we're talking about civil society and the role that they play in Syria, holding communities together, and also not just and the need for them to have the need for there to be protection of civilians and of civil society, because when you have that, they can play a bigger role, not just in holding communities together and resisting injustice, but also resisting extremism and pushing back extremist groups. We saw that when the ceasefire started, the cessation of hostilities started, that the next Friday, people in 100 different communities went out to protest. And they weren't just protesting against the regime. They still very much were adamant that they do not want the regime. They do not want to go back. But they also didn't want to be under Jabhat al-Nusra or ISIS. They also were rejecting tyranny. They were holding the revolution flag, which has come to mean not just that they're against the regime, but that they're also reject these extremist groups. And they were making a strong statement. And this is when you have the space, when you are able to have that space, the ability to, the protection from the daily shelling, then these communities are able to push and to resist tyranny. And so if we accept as Syrians that the administration or the U.S. doesn't actually necessarily care about Syrians and their fate, if what they're concerned about is ISIS, then also protecting civilians is part of an anti-extremism strategy. It needs to be broader than just bombing. They need to look at, you can't fight terrorism by just bombing, by continuing to bomb. You need to build these communities that are the ones that are the first, they're the first victims, but they're also the first line, there are the people who are doing the anti-extremism work on the ground. The other thing we were saying, and the other thing that I think we got was a sense of, well, and just to be, we're not sure that anything's going to happen in this administration. We're not sure that anything, maybe we'll wait till the new administration, maybe there'll be change then. And I think, as we see, not just first of all, that the infrastructure is being systematically destroyed, the civilian infrastructure is being destroyed, but also that people are, and we saw like when the Russian bombings were happening, you had every 3 days a hospital or medical infrastructure was being destroyed, and now you've had a hospital and medical center destroyed in 2 days. Today and yesterday. And I think, when this kinds of mass, destruction is happening, it's very difficult for communities to stay and resist whether extremism and to continue to survive. And we've seen a lot of people leave in the last year because it has been very difficult, where you have ISIS hitting you, attacking you from the ground, and you have the regime from the sky. And so I think the sense of urgency is what also we need to, we've been trying to get across.
I think you've said everything, but I'll just add two quick things, is that civil society today who are doing, starting from providing services, ending to the documentations of human rights violations or all this kind of peace work, are the ones who have legitimacy on the ground right now. Syrian people do have a lot of questions when it comes to legitimacy about the coalition, opposition groups, Assad regime, other groups as well. But when it comes to the civil society organizations and groups on the ground, they've been perceived by everyone as the one who providing services, are the one who filling the gap of the absence of the government, etc. So in order to have, and we know, we realize from now that having a strong civil society now is going to influence the future of us, and having a strong civil society means that we will have a better future. A lot of challenges that civil society are facing today can be dealt with. More support can be channeled to those organizations and groups. To emphasize on what Salma is saying, protection of civilians, that comes number one. And if we want to actually defeat ISIS, we need to end the war in Syria. We need to bring all actors into the negotiation table. The solution is political. It's not, and there is no military solution to the conflict in Syria. And bombing ISIS is not going to solve the problem. We need to put more pressure on the Assad regime to come and negotiate. We need to ban the barrel bombs and the airstrikes so Syrian civilians can have a better, life. They don't have to flee to Turkey and Lebanon, and the number of the IDPs will be absolutely limited if we initiated a kind of protection for civilian and implement the UN resolution that call for that. In addition to the barrel bombs, but also providing humanitarian aid and access and get the siege left and release detainees, etc. All this like an essential steps that need to be happen in order to the peace talk to be really effective.
Okay, I'm just going to ask one very, very quick question. Women in politics, your voices are important for the policy debates. And in a leading policy analysis that's circulating now is that if the Geneva talks fail, we will go to partition or devolution of power or some sort of decentralization arrangement. Given your experience and knowledge as Syrians and activists, is that possible? Would it work?
I don't think it's going to work. I mean, the only solution is getting to a negotiated agreement where basically keep the country all as one piece. No matter how Syria would look like as a state in the future, I mean, the Syrian people have to decide whether it's a federation, whether it's having a different kind of system. But like as a solution to keep everyone in control now of a piece of Syria, that's absolutely not a solution. It's only going, even if this solution was a temporary solution, but it's only going to create a negative peace where you will have the conflict back again in a few years, and absolutely not a sustainable solution. People have to sit on the table and negotiate. Assad has to leave, because that's what the future, if we want to build a future Syria, that means we need to get rid of our criminal first.
Can you wait for the mic? Thank you all for your remarks today. I'm Rebecca Sheff with Human Rights First. So apart from what the US government can do to better support civil society within Syria, is there more that the government here could do to support civil society organizations operating in the frontline states who face tremendous challenges with doing work across the border to sustain the efforts that organizations like yours are doing to support civil society within the country?
I think there are, as in addition to groups that are working on the ground, small groups that are working on the ground, we find that also there needs to be more support to Syrian groups that are working from Turkey, Lebanon. Not many groups working in Jordan now because there's very little space for Syrian civil society to work in Jordan. And we find that it's, some of the challenges we face are related to mobility. The being able to meet our colleagues from Syria, for groups to go out, to be able to get training,
to be able to do advocacy, as we were just saying. This, you know, there is, Ola's been talking about the fact that the Turkish government has passes for humanitarian actors, local councils, and armed groups. But, you know, if you're civil society activists or your organizations that are working on issues like human rights and democracy, these you don't have access. And this is really important, the issue of mobility. The other one is related to what kinds of funding are available to these organizations, because often the funding comes in short pieces, where you get 3 months to do youth engagement and development, or 6 months. You also get very specific project funding where it's only to implement, and often you don't have support for the organization in order to be able to do advocacy, to do coordination, to be able to put out position papers and do consultation. Those things require that you engage with your peers, and that is a process. So there needs to be more support for organizations as organizations, not just project funding.
I don't know if you wanted to say more about that. My
name is Dee Dee Cutler, and I was fortunate enough in October of 2010 to be invited by the Syrian government to photograph the country. And I was taken all over. Syria, as you know, was hot. Everybody was going. Tourism represented 13% of the annual budget. I met with many women who headed up NGOs, the Minister of Culture, and I was also extremely impressed that any organization or institution that had more than 10 women in it had to have compulsory daycare center, which we don't have here.
What? Do you have a question?
Yes. My question is, I know that you have to be involved in the peacekeeping, but what are the specific ways or organizations that you're dealing with hospitals, wounded people, children out of school who need education?
Well, I think women have been involved in all kinds of work. I mean, they've been doing, there are some women-specific groups, as Ola was saying, that are doing peacekeeping work, but there's also a lot of women that are involved in the humanitarian work, and they have been since the beginning of the uprising. They have been involved in getting aid because of their, initially, because of their, you know, they're seen as women, that they're not going to be, you know, that they're not seen as a threat. They're able to use that to get, for instance, blood bags, is it? Into area, you know, to provide supplies for the field clinics, to be able to do that kind of humanitarian work. And they're still doing a lot of work. And as I, you know, have been mentioning, there's groups, there's a group in Dara that started with 13 young people, men and women, doing education programming, doing some little program. Now they've grown into actually managing 11 schools. There's a lot of different groups, and women have started to organize, young people particularly started to organize and have gotten to, they are the ones that are providing most of the humanitarian support in the country.
Hi, I'm Najla Drubi, and I have a cousin and a son who are reporters, and just last week or this week I told them, enough, please, horror stories. Can we have some hopeful stories of people who are doing something good in Syria? So I'm really glad to hear from you, and maybe I can get them in touch with you. But the question I have is, are you working also with women in Lebanon, in the refugee camps, or in Jordan, or in Turkey? What is their involvement? And also, what is the involvement of the women here in the States or in Europe or whatever? And are the people, most importantly, are the women in Syria divided as pro and against regime as this is happening here?
um,
Yeah, there are plenty of stories that brings hope. But as I said, I mean, always reporting about war, but not about peace work and the great work that is being carried out by people on the ground. We both organizations, we don't actually work with refugees in the countries that we are working with. And for Badael, we have our main office in Turkey, but our work is all inside the country and our team are based inside. However, there are plenty of organizations who are basically working with refugees, whether in Lebanon or in Turkey. Much more, I would say, in Lebanon, because there is a space for Lebanese organization and Syrian organization to function, while it's harder in Turkey because it has to go through a long process that the government, the Turkish Red Cross basically dealing with camps in Turkey. So it's harder in Turkey, much easier in Lebanon. I think there are some initiatives where some international organizations are mobilizing people from the region to support Syrians or also to share experience. I would give the International Women League for Peace and Freedom, who've been doing a lot of work to bring women together. Even I participated with them, for example, in a meeting where they bring Bosnian women and Syrian women together to share experience. So absolutely, there are solidarity and there are groups who are basically supporting women. But I believe that we need more basically of this kind of support to show more solidarity with the Syrian civil society and women groups.
Yes, hi. Thanks, Leila. Good to see you, ladies, again. My question is, Joyce Karam with Al Hayat newspaper. I came late, sorry. I don't know if you touched upon that, but can you tell us a little bit about yourselves? How did you get involved in this? I mean, I recognize it's much easier to be like us, like any one of us here today, and say, to hell with it, let them figure it out. And on the question of, what does the average Syrian want today? We hear from Obama, we hear from Demastura, from Bashar al-Assad. But in your contact with, average Syrians, what's their immediate needs and what's their, outlook for an exit strategy from this?
So, what am I doing here? I'm Syrian, who was born in Syria. I left for Canada when I was 15 and went back when I was 23 because I wanted to find community. I'd been organizing in Canada on student rights and women's rights and anti-racism and anti-globalization. I was going to summit hopping, as I don't know if many of you are probably too young to remember the Seattle and so on, but I wanted to go back to Syria and find out what's happening, and it was very difficult for me to kind of engage and to find ways in which to actually find and to build community with the different activist groups, because I was really an outsider, it was very difficult to actually connect with people. And what I'm doing now is I found that if I'm not engaged in the revolution, or I'm not engaged in the struggle for freedom and democracy, then I cannot expect it to look like me. I mean, it's not going to look like me. It looks like a lot of people, but I wanted to be part of it and to help shape the struggle and help shape what values and what ideas are put forward, and to be part of that. And I've seen a lot of people who are saying, well, this doesn't look like me. That's not the kind of revolution that I wanted. That's not what we, I can't say that. I have to be in it and try to participate and shape it and make it, continue to keep it a struggle about justice and freedom.
And your second question, people want the war to stop. They're tired. They're exhausted. But they also want, really want accountability, and they also want, they want freedom. I mean, we've seen that when they look, go out, as soon as the ceasefire started, they went out and protested again, because there, we haven't been out, we didn't lose everything so that we could go back and either have al-Nusra or Assad come and rule us. They still want those things. They still believe in those things. And I think that, we need, that's what I, keep hearing from people.
I have nothing to add to the second question. I think people would want to end the war, but they want dignity as well. Quickly about your question, I was born in a city called Tartus, and I am coming from a secular family that was, my dad was always an opposition since Hafez Assad came to the power. So I get the chance throughout the family to learn about this regime since I was a very, very little child. And then took the decision to fight for freedom and human rights. And that's how I get involved right after Damascus Spring. I was 19 years old, and since then I've been advocating for human rights. Quickly to say that when the uprising happened in 2011, for me it was a complete surprise. It was not expected. I didn't feel that the Syrian society are ready to go on in the uprising. But thanks for the Arab Spring and the neighboring countries that they actually helped us in calling for freedom and human rights. And despite of the risk that we have been taking over the past 5 years, but I think Syrian have decided 5 years ago to go to the street and call for freedom and human rights, and they absolutely deserve to end this war. But they deserve to have a democratic state where human rights are respected.
Thank you both for coming. We so appreciate hearing stories from the ground. Rachel Levy, I coming from the World Bank. I support your summit hopping. Question for Oula. You spoke about the anti-recruitment programs that were done through the literary initiatives. And I was just wondering, it seems an uphill battle to be fighting. I imagine young people are frustrated and tired, as you've spoken of, and want to do something. And I think peace is a hard choice. So I'm wondering just if you could speak more about the details of those programs, how successful they were. Just digging in a little more. I'm curious. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nadine Wahab. I'm actually a human rights defender from Egypt. So Salma, I had a very similar story, having grown up as an activist here and then decided to go back. Hi, Leila. One of the key things that I've realized, I work for a regional organization, so focus on Syria, Yemen, and Libya, and looking at international advocacy, is that we've given up our agency, both as women as Arabs. We look at international actors to come fix our situations, and at women, I find it more and more that we're talking to men about issues that really do concern us. So I'm trying to see if maybe there's an opportunity, or you guys saw something that could help us reformulate the situation where we are no longer looking at international actors, looking at an Arab for Arab solution, and specifically one where women set the table and we're equal partners at finding a solution.
Hi, my name is Lauren Kunis. I work for the National Democratic Institute, NDI. We do a lot of work at the local level with local councils. And I definitely agree with everything you said today about women really flourishing as civil society activists, but at least in our assessment of the situation, I think we can't really say the same for women in local councils and their participation in local government. And first of all, I guess I would want to know if you agree with that. And if you do, I was wondering for your thoughts on why that is and what we can do about it.
So about the projects that's related to child recruitment. I have to say that this, the group that I've mentioned, the examples of recruitment are one of our partners, so we are aware that this project has to stop due to lack of support after a while. So as Selma was talking about the challenges that civil society are facing, if you provide support for 3 months or 6 months, that will not last and the impact will be much, much less. While if you have more sustainability in the support, then you will get more impact of such projects. Not only in this group that have been working on child recruitment, but we know of other initiatives that under ISIS control, for example, they've been doing similar kind of work through taking out children, doing some kind of entertainment, football games, etc., and through that providing non-violent communication to the children. But again, this does not deal with the main cause of the problem, because the main cause of the problem is economic. People in Deir ez-Zor, which is a city that is divided, half of it, or like 50,000 people live under ISIS control area, and 300 people living under the regime area. They don't have an income, basically, and people are forced to basically send their children to get the $200 at the end of the month. So this kind of project, it's important and it helps, it supports, but it has a little kind of impact on the whole problem. On the other side, you would have, we need to have a more of, there are groups who are basically based outside and inside the country. I'll give an example, Hurras, who's dealing a lot with children and providing supports. But what is need to happen now is to like, organizations come together to like design kind of a complete cycle of support. So providing psychological support, providing case management for child recruitment, providing livelihood and life skills and education opportunity. This is how you can actually, in a comprehensive way, deal with the child recruitment. But it's hard sometimes to manage the impact if you have like small pieces here and there. And this is where the support need to be, focused to like bring this all these efforts and create more sustainable opportunity for the civil society to take on with the work that they are doing. And I'll leave to Selma, but I'm gonna answer respond to your question about women in local councils. I absolutely agree with you. Women are almost not representative at all in the local councils, and that's a huge problem for all of us. We understand that women has to be in this leadership position on the local level in order to having the rule itself, but also to deal with other women issues that basically local councils are not dealing with. I'll give you one example of how we deal with the issue as Badael. I'll give two examples, which make it better to understand. So we have like one of our partners, a women group, that we've been working with them on like building their capacity, providing different kind of training and consultancy to them, and then later on provided also sub grants for some of the work that they are doing. And on the other hand, we were in parallel working with the local councils on providing also training and capacity building and trying to have this kind of information about how important to include women. So at the end, after 1 year of working with the two in parallel, we had the coordinator of the women group asked to join the local councils, and now she's managing the section or the department that is related to women and children. It's not convincing for me that women only have to deal with women and children issue. This is stereotyping. This is not the gender equality that we are looking for. Absolutely agree. But I wanted to give this example to say that it's a step by step. It's very hard in a community that is full of violence to haven't had, you know, like women's rights before or equality, to just come from the top and say, well, we want 50% of the women in the local councils. That's absolutely not going to happen. And I'm going to give like another quick example. We have another partner group, a women group in Aleppo, actually, that we are now supporting a project, supporting their project, where they are launching a couple of dialogue sessions between the local councils and the women, and the women and the civil society actors. And they are aiming to two things: more inclusion of women and more participation and representation of women in the local councils. And they're trying to address this issue through dialogue sessions with the local councils in Aleppo. And the other one is to have more women on members in the civil society actors there, and through this dialogue to reach out to that place. So it takes time. We know it's going to be very hard, but slowly, slowly, I think we can get there.
Yeah, I'll maybe address your point about civil society, Syrian activists, Syrian organizations have grown a lot in the last 5 years. we're learning to trust each other, work more with each other, build alliances, and try to be more proactive about what we want and what we need, and trying to put our needs on the agenda. It's been a long process. It's also been a difficult process because there's been a move for various reasons, and the economic situation, the livelihood situation because of the war, there has been an NGOization of the movement, where we have, we're all becoming organizations looking at projects, looking at funding, rather than looking at what, you know, and we've had, and we need to do that. In some ways, there is some work that needs to be done in terms of becoming more professional or being able to manage funds. But we're also working on ways in which we can work together that do not involve funding and do not involve platforms that are funded by others. And that's something we've struggled with, is because we've been also offered, as organizations, ready-made platforms, come and organize and get your voice across in this way. And we've time and time again kind of said no, and we've rejected these kinds of platforms. Last year, Badael and Dawlaty were two of the organizations that started a campaign called Planet Syria, and with 114 other organizations that have signed up. And it was really an initiative where, I mean, because we had also, we have our staff, our funding, but without asking for funding for this, and we refused to get, for the most part, funding to actually do this campaign and to do this kind of coalition work, because we didn't want it to be tied to any political agenda. And we continue, you know, there's been a lot of organizing that we've been doing with other organizations now, related to the London conference, related to the World Humanitarian Summit, related to Geneva, that is not part of any official platform, that has been kind of, you know, here, take this, organize within here. And I think we've really come, you know, it's starting to pay off. We're starting to be able to also find amongst each other ways in which to do this kind of work, and also to be more inclusive of others, but on our terms. Because we've also been there's been a lot of pressure to be more inclusive, but in a way where, include these government-sponsored NGOs or these government-affiliated NGOs, and you need to be inclusive of this. And we're saying, you know, and this is also in the case of women's organizing, is, okay, you need to be inclusive, but, you know, we're saying if we see a common interest, we'll work together on something, but we're not going to be, you know, these coalitions and this kind of alliance can't come from the top. So it's a work in progress.
Okay, so we can take it's a great way to end, but if we have other questions, please feel free, we have more time, and but we'll take a new.
Can you hear me? Veronica Baker. I'm a research assistant here at the Middle East Institute. And in the initial uprisings in 2011, there was so much intra-regional information sharing between civil society actors in Syria, Tunisia, Egypt, throughout. I'm wondering today if there's any information sharing with civil society in other countries. Maybe Tunisia has been a little more successful helping with the strategy of civil society activism in Tunisia or in Syria.
It's not a question. I just want to share a lessons learned in case you guys decide to raise money for these organizations. I, as a Quaker, we're raising funds for Syrian refugees. Just one quick thing because it's important. And we accepted money through PayPal, and just because we put in the note it's for Syrian refugees, the money got stopped. So do not put the word Syrian anywhere in any fundraising.
What criminal activity did you do to get kicked out of Syria? Somebody was banned from Syria. It says Ramadan.
Can you identify yourself?
I'm just a student. No name is necessary, right? Melissa. My name is just Melissa. Mafish. Okay. It says Oula Ramadan was banned from traveling to Syria from 2006 to 2011. For her work. What was criminal about the work?
Being a human rights activist. That was my crime, dear.
Do you believe your perception of human rights is different than there?
If you allow me, then I'll let you also ask you a question. That's one of the honors that I will carry on my life, all my life. So go ahead with your question.
Do you believe your perception of human rights is different from the Middle Eastern reality?
From the what?
Middle Eastern reality.
Should that all?
I think that, you know, we're often faced with the idea that human rights is too much or democracy is too much for people of the Middle East. That if you let them decide what they are going to do, it's going to cause chaos. And I think that's, first of all, really racist. It's also, I think, you know, time and time again, and as we've seen in many of the local communities where people, when they have had the chance, have done amazing, amazing work to produce ideas, art, media, and also local activism, I think, and initiatives. And so there is, with the right support, and with the right, without being bombed constantly and tortured to death, and being starved, the Syrians have been shown that they not only deserve freedom, but it is suited to them. They thrive under it, and they can offer a lot to their communities, but also to the world. And the
sharing experience with
that. Between Arab countries.
Have you?
I think there are few initiatives that I can remember that is mainly run by international organizations, but not that many actually. Especially when it comes to the Arab countries or the region, Tunisia, Egypt, etc., to bring people together, is very few initiatives.
Well, thanks to the Middle East Institute for sponsoring, and thanks to Oula and Salma for the very enlightening discussion, and thanks to everyone for coming out.